this panel, responses to the euro crisis, strategies for the degrowth movement, which leads on very nicely from the keynote speech we heard this morning from Haris Konstantatos and Barbara Muraca. And I will be emceeing this lovely panel. My name is Tadja Müller. I work for the Rosa Luxemburg Foundation in Berlin on climate and energy issues and have been involved for a while in the alter globalization and climate justice movements. And before I introduce the speakers, I wanted to briefly set up the debate with a few sentences about the potential relationship between this issue of euro crisis and the degrowth movement, insofar as it is a movement. Degrowth, we've been told, criticizes the focus on economic growth as the solution to all ills. But an obvious and easy challenge to this position, which you may have all encountered in your own political work and your experience, is to accuse the degrowth movement of being articulated from a very privileged northern position. That is to say, from a position of from a position where the problem is too much rather than too little. And those critics then point to the global south or to the south in the north, say the European periphery, Greece, Spain, Portugal, Ireland, as sort of areas where a degrowth agenda may not at all be relevant. And on the face of it, there seems to be something to this challenge. And dealing with this challenge is the subject of our panel, and I hope we take a few steps forward. Because the question for me is essentially, what do we say to a Greek comrade who reminds us that over the course of the crisis, household income in Greece has decreased by one third, GDP has shrunken by a quarter, and youth unemployment stands around 55%. General unemployment stands around 27. In Spain, another country strongly affected by the crisis, youth unemployment figures are around 53% at this point. So how do we respond? How do we deal with this crisis from the perspective of the degrowth movement? And how do we use it, maybe, even as a potential moment of transformation? Since, as somebody said, never let a good crisis go to waste. In short, what does the degrowth movement have to say? What does it demand in this great recession? And to debate these important questions, we are very happy to welcome three excellent speakers to this panel. I'll start in the order of how the presenters are going to speak. Stefan Lange, who is a co-organizer of this conference and active in the Konzeptwerk Neue Ökonomie here in Leipzig. Then the second presentation will be given by Yorgos Velegrakis, final speaker will be Nicola Bollard, who is a, she's not actually with the Rosa Luxemburg Foundation, as much as we would love that to be the case. She's a fellow traveler and a long-standing climate justice and alter global activist. And so, without much further ado, Stefan, you have the floor. What do we say to this recession?
Thank you, Tadjo. Is this loud enough? Yeah, okay. Okay, let me start with a small anecdote. Yesterday I had a radio interview and the central question of the moderator was, okay, apparently you say the economies should stop growing, but look at Greece, look at Spain, look at Italy. There the economies don't grow anymore and they have huge problems. So why are you demanding a degrowth society? And of course my answer was, well, the crisis of those states is not the degrowth society that I would demand or that we would demand. That was obvious for me. You know, this, you probably, many of you know this, the sentence, degrowth by design and not disaster. That was so obvious to me, but it became apparent to me that, well, many people don't know that, that we don't mean like just keeping the same economy and stop growing. That a degrowth society is something very different. And I hope we come closer to this, to the answer how to react to this crisis and in such a manner on this podium. What I want to do is two things. First, I'm going to sketch out very shortly how what happened in the crisis and what were the policy responses in reality. And in the second part, I want to try to sketch out how socio-ecological responses could have looked like and partly still can look like. So kind of a post-growth agenda. Shortly to the crisis. From my point of view, the story goes something like this. There were big trade imbalances within Europe before the crisis. So some countries had very big trade deficits. They exported less than they imported. Other countries had big trade surpluses. So Germany is most important to mention there, with around 6% of GDP as a trade surplus. So there were big trade imbalances within Europe. And in this situation came the financial crisis that led to recessions within many countries all over Europe. One of the important responses to the financial crisis was that banks had to be bailed out. And the governments had to pay for that, and that led to a big increase in public debts. And in this situation where many countries were in recession and the public debts increased, the very powerful financial markets started betting against those countries that they would not be able to pay back their debts. And that actually led to an increase of interest rates, and then they were not able to. And then they had to seek help from somewhere, and kind of the agent to go to was what was later on called the Troika. So that's the European Commission, the IMF, and the Central Bank, in order to get credits from them. But the Troika only gives credits under certain conditions. So they say, if you want credits, you have to implement certain policies. And what were those policies that had to be implemented or that were implemented? Of course, it's very difficult to say that for so many countries, but I think there were two big strands of policies that have been implemented. The first is as a response to the big public deficits, the public expenditures were decreased. So for example, in Greece, the public expenditures between 2009 and 2013 decreased by 25%. That's immense decrease. That's the first one. The second big economic policy response is, from my point of view, that it was tried to decrease the production costs in the crisis states so that they would become more competitive, so that they could sell their products on the international markets. What does that mean? I guess you can tell more about that, but very generally speaking, the wages were cut. So these two policies, cutting public expenditures and cutting wages, led first to a big increase in inequality, and second to a further recession, because there was a lack of demand, so the economy got into another slump. So that's kind of the two big aspects of economic policies. What I also think is important to mention is that those policies were very weakly democratically legitimized. They were strongly pushed by the Troika, and as I said, these institutions in there, they are very weakly democratically legitimized. Also important is that there was almost no environmental agenda within the policy responses. So to sum up, there were cuts in public expenditures, decreasing wages, less democratic control, and no environmental agenda. That's kind of, from my point of view, a very short story of the policy responses to the euro crisis. So what would have been more socially, ecological, and democratically sound responses? I want to mention four points. It's redistribution, strengthening democratic institutions, sufficiency policies, and strengthen local economies. Coming to redistribution. So instead of, as I said, the response to the big public deficits was to cut public expenditures. An alternative would have been to redistribute in the way that you tax high-income members of society all over Europe, and you tax big companies, and you use this money for the budgets and the deficits of the countries who need it, in this case, the crisis states. That would have been one way of redistribution. The other way of redistribution would have been, instead of decreasing the wages in the crisis states, one could have kind of increased the wage costs, for example, in Germany, and a very smart post-growth answer could have been to reduce working hours, not actually increase the wages, but reduce working hours, then you have an increase in hourly wages and higher costs in Germany, so that Germany exports less and other countries can export more. And the third point of redistribution that I want to mention is that we need to put a lot of energy in stopping tax fraud and tax evasion. Just to give you a number, there is an estimated 1 trillion euro of tax fraud all over Europe in a year. That's double the size of the yearly public deficit all over Europe. So just by doing that, one could solve that problem. Okay, so that was concerning redistribution. Coming to my second point, strengthening democratic institutions. I want to keep that short. From my point of view, first, the within the democratic institution itself, the European Parliament could be strengthened, as opposed to, for example, the European Commission. On the European level, financial markets could be and should be controlled, because we have seen what impacts the strong financial markets had in the crisis. And thirdly, the financial and business lobby should be controlled, because they were the ones who actually pushed the policies that led to the crisis in the first place. Third, the sufficiency policies. So how can we make this whole thing also environmentally sound? I already mentioned working hours reductions, especially in the surplus countries. That would not only have the impact of increasing wage costs, but also giving people more time for a good life. The second one would be environmental taxation. I would also demand that on a European level. That would not only, you know, have the good effect of making environmentally harmful goods more expensive, but also one could use the money from the taxation to give it, for example, to the governments of the countries in crisis. And if a country decides to invest, what I think in a recession in the economy that we have right now is also reasonable, the investments should be in environmentally intelligent ways. So, for example, in Germany, after the crisis, we had this Abwrackprämie, which was to give everybody who wants to buy a new car 2,500 euros as a subsidy. I mean, okay, I don't want to go into that, but I think from an environmental point of view, it's really not useful at all. So instead, one could have invested, for example, in local railroad systems, or there are many other ways to invest more reasonably. And my fourth point, strengthening local economies. I think the connection there to the crisis is that local economies are a lot more resilient to global crises, and they can be supported in many ways. I just want to mention two. One example could be that public institutions buy locally, and another could be to increase transport costs. So that makes sense from an environmental point of view and would also strengthen local economies. We have to be careful there that we don't connect that to nationalism from my point of view. You know, it's about local economies and not about national economies. Okay, just to sum up, the four points again that I think are important is redistribution, strengthening democratic institutions, sufficiency policies, and strengthening local economies. Thanks.
Thank you very much. That was
not only excellently cogent, it was also brilliantly on time. And I always forget to sort of point out what the structure of the workshop is going to be. Well, all the speakers will speak for about 10 minutes, give or take. And then I'll have another round of questions directly that I will ask them after the first round of presentation. And then we'll open up to the floor and we'll have the microphone over there. So just as a brief point to how we're going to go. So. And by the way, if I seem cruel during the next presentation, Yorgos asked me to like be really tough on the time, so I hope I'm not going to be absolutely impolite, but you've got 10 minutes, mate.
Well, thank you, Tadjo. Can you hear me? Yes, you can. I had a PowerPoint presentation, but in order to save time, and I'm not going to be up there. So, Tadjo introduced some things about myself. I just want to say that I come here as academic researcher, as ecological environmental activist, and as member of a political party of the left that somehow tries to work on the socio-ecological transformation. So I'm having this identity here that I want to bring up some points. My presentation, my speech will have 4 points. The first one is that I will have 2 theoretical points on the growth and political ecology. Then some things about Greece, about the political situation on one hand, and on the other hand, to understand why I think Greece is crucial at the moment. Some aspects of the socio-ecological movements and leading to some conclusions. I will try to read the part of it in order to save time. So, first of all, as Haris Konstantatos pointed out this morning, in the current European debt crisis, there is a comeback of the north-south divide in the spatial imagination of Europe, and constructions which attribute negative characteristics to the south in order to legitimize spatial hierarchies in Europe. So this is a very important point. So I think it's crucial for academic social movements and the anti-capitalistic political organization to work on the issue of the uneven development within Europe in order to firstly understand these processes and secondly provide the discourse, the imaginary and the political practices of the alternatives. Second point quickly on the theoretical part. Yesterday, Federico De Maria said that the growth is a missile word for the current system of accumulation. I think that in order degrowth to be truly a missile world, we should try to transform this concept from a missile world to a dangerous political practice for the capitalist system of accumulation. So, in my opinion, this can be done only if, first, we confront current power structures, second, work on the transformation of the property relations, analyze and struggle against capitalism on its different scales and not only on the local level, and try to unify the environmental, workers and other social struggles in a broader political praxis. These two things that I put as introduction, I had a third one about Marxist political ecology, but I don't have time for it. I think is the starting point for my analysis of Greece, my presentation about Greece. So, first of all, why Greece? What is the crucial moment of Greece at the moment? I think in Greece at the moment there is a historical moment of transformation that we should pay attention to. There are 3 key elements. Firstly, the impact of the memorandum policies on Greek labor relations is unprecedented in Greek and European political history. As I said before, the creation of what I call spaces of dispossession brings up again the issue of uneven development within Europe. So on one part, we have the dominant policies. On the second point is that from the protests of the Greek December of 2008 to the Indignados movement in 2011, general strikes and everyday struggles, continuous movements, are developing in a very creative ways and seem to determine the political outcomes. So my second point is that in Greece, at the moment, we have a current history of social movements that we should pay attention to. And the third point is that the political context is unsustainable and extremely dynamic, if only to consider the enormous growth of the radical left on one hand, and the parallel right-wing extremism. So these are the 3 points that I want to bring up. Dominant policies, history and current environmental movements, social and environmental movements, and the political context which is dynamic and unsustainable. I'm going to talk a bit more about these dominant policies on two key aspects that I think are key aspects for the moment. It's the issue of land and the issue of energy. Firstly, about land. from 2009 on, the crisis in Greece has decisively contributed to the devaluation of the exchange value of land, decreasing monetary values by 15 or 30% depending on the area when compared to 2005 prices. The special status imposed as of 2010 forms a lucrative environment for speculators investors, dramatically altering the legal constitution order and imposing something of protectorate states status upon the country. So, according to the Troika analysts, Greece experiences some delayed mobility of land values when compared to the rest of Europe. So, what is needed right now in Greece is a normalization of the Greek exception in the same, let's say, paths of the rest of Europe. Land and real estate must therefore follow the path of what was happening in the rest of Europe. Privatization of large public areas, land ownership centralization, and obligatory capitalist modernization of the land. A key role in this readjustment play new institutional and legislative systems. The most known one is the Hellenic Republic Asset Development Fund, a new organization that was developed during the crisis just for promoting land privatization and exploitation. The examples are a lot all over Greece. I'm going to talk about quickly about three. The first one is in the north of Greece, in Chalkidiki, where an area of 31,000 hectares is being sold to a Canadian company in order to extract gold. The second one is the south of Greece, in the island, on the island of Creta, where we have an English company called Itanos Gea that is buying an area of 2,500 hectares for touristic development. And the third case is on the coastal front of Attica, nearby Athens, that an area of 600 hectares, that includes the old airport of Olyniko, is thought to be, is advertised as the largest urban plot in the Mediterranean Sea. So we have these new investments in land in these places. How am I with time?
I was going to just reach the 3 minute sign.
Okay. So the other big issue is the energy issue. I don't have much time to say a lot of things, but I think it's something that we will have to confront in the very near future. There is a big project of privatization of the electrical grid and of the production of and the power, sell off of the productive power plants of the public company PPC. And what is interesting is that although we are talking about, at least is promoting, the government is promoting this privatization as opportunities for new investments in the energy sector, what is actually being seen is that investments never appear. So I think, therefore, a tool of mechanism to explain this process of vast privatization in the energy, other than from the neoliberal dogma of free market, I think is the monopoly rent ensured through such fields of exploitation. And energy is a very good, let's say, place for this monopoly rent. So to conclude this part, I argue that in Greece today, the dominant policies produce new spaces and new environments. Full privatization of land and infrastructure, land grabbing, and exclusion of large population for using public goods. On the other hand, and I will be brief in order not to be pessimistic, in Greece there is a big history, at least during the last 20 years, of socio-environmental movements. I want to point out that I think these movements can produce alternative, antagonistic, let's say, spaces and environments against the dominant ones. There are a lot of examples. I will focus quickly on three cases. The first case is an overview of what I call emerging moments in urban political ecology of Greece, which is an overview of the big social struggles in the city centers, especially in Athens, starting from, let's say, mid-2000, 2005. Then we had the big student movement of 2006 and 7, the youth uprising of 2008, of course the memorandum, the Indignados movement in 2011, and the occupation of national broadcast last summer. What I want to say is that these movements, although defensive, managed to threaten temporarily the power structures, act against the alienation of everyday life that capitalism produces, and bring back the political question, the power question. At the same time, on environmental issues, I think they produce a new spaces of democracy and new spaces of possibilities for socio-ecological transformation. The other case, quickly, has to do with, let's say, pure environmental movements. There are two pivotal case studies. The one is in a waste conflict in 2010 in Greece that was in Keratea nearby Athens, and the other is the struggle against the gold mine that I said before in Chalkidiki. I don't have much time to tell you about these movements, but I think they are crucial because, firstly, the struggles themselves showed how business will be done in crisis period, not only in Greece, but also in Europe. Secondly, they showed what is the reaction of the state. We have huge police brutality, oppression, and a quick response to the uprising of these movements. And thirdly, the optimistic part is that we have models of struggles that are very crucial in time and space and give opportunities for new political outcomes. I would like to finish with some conclusions on more general ideas, but I'm leaving it for maybe the next question because I think I'm over time.
You can always ignore my question and just talk about what you want to talk about. That is a traditional, I understand that's a traditional way to behave on panels. So I'll ask one or two questions and then you just talk about what you want.
Yeah. Okay.
I shouldn't have said that. Those are like facilitation secrets. Okay, thank you very much and for sticking in the time. Nicola, what's your response? What are your ideas on these questions? Oh, you need a microphone.
Yeah. And thanks, Tadjo. And also, please give me a time signal. Yeah. So, hi, good morning, everyone. My name's Nicola, and I'm one of the questions that I was asked in the invitation to join this panel is, what can European movements learn from other regions? Okay, the other regions, I guess, refers to what we might call the South. My only, I guess, legitimacy for speaking to this question is that I lived and worked for about 15 years in Thailand, and I worked with an organisation and, you know, doing a lot of campaigning around neoliberal globalisation, anti-capitalist on land, water, energy, trade, finance, a lot of different local campaigns and movements, and trying to link that to what was happening at the international level and making those connections. So what I want to, I guess, my first reaction is to try and locate what's happening in Europe in a broader context, and to say, you know, this is not the first time that a country has been structurally adjusted by neoliberal policies, and therefore, what can we learn, and what are the possibilities that open up for us if we think about what's happening in Europe as part of a global process of structural adjustment and forced reintegration or forced integration of national economies into a globalized economy, because that's in fact what's happening. So I want to just give a small anecdote, which is perhaps relevant. In 1999, 2 years after the Asian financial crisis, which was in 1997, which some of you may remember was a financial crisis which had sort of, in sort of classic terms, the same origins as described by Stefan, that there was a, you know, imbalance in trade, and there was some kind of vulnerability which was identified by the financial markets, who then speculated and forced a run on the currency, which forced governments to, you know, basically dry up the central bank, try and fend off the speculators. Then they were forced to go to the IMF and the World Bank to get a loan. There were conditions attached to the loan which forced them to privatise, liberalise, open up sectors of the economy that had previously been protected or government controlled, to make land available for foreigners to buy, etc., etc., etc. All of the things that have happened in Greece have happened in dozens of countries of the South, and it's the same pattern. So back to 1999 at the UNCTAD, UN Conference on Trade and Development, had one of their sort of big meetings. Actually, it was in 2000 in Bangkok. And it was at this big conference centre, and at the time Michel Camdessous was the director of the IMF. And he was speaking in this, you know, huge plenary session with lots of diplomats and ambassadors and trade ministers and so forth. And this was back in the good old days when people used to do pieing, right? And so someone came with a cake and basically just pushed it into Michel Camdessous' face, which caused, of course, a great uproar. And, you know, the next day on the sort of the top half of the Financial Times, which is like the prime media spot in the whole world, there was a photograph of Michel Camdessous with like cream smeared on the side of his face and a glacé cherry on his nose, right? And so this was an absolutely fantastic image, and it was just such a brilliant evocation, right, of the attitude that people had towards the IMF, right? A sort of a mix of contempt and wanting to target them and so on. And okay, so just and we happen to know the person who did the pieing, but until this day, we would not claim any sort of direct link to the act itself. And the person who did the pieing was a very good activist from the US called Rob Naiman. And he came to our office at the university the next day, and he was flocked by this sort of gang of, you know, 19-year-old female university students, because he'd become an overnight star, because he had targeted the International Monetary Fund, which at that time in Thailand, which was in the middle of a big financial crisis, was seen as the ultimate enemy. So the, you know, the fact that this guy had made a very sort of deliberate and symbolic act against the institution, the International Monetary Fund, was greeted with huge popular support. It was seen as an okay thing to do. And so all that is to say that I think one of the lessons that we can learn from the South is that all of these countries, Argentina, Egypt, Indonesia, Korea, all of these countries that have suffered through structural adjustment and huge economic crisis, have built up movements, very political movements, that have struggled and fought against these policies. But at the same time, they made a very clear identification of the institutions and the powers that were responsible for these policies. So it wasn't a sort of a vague thing, right? I mean, people were naming things as they were. This is neoliberalism. This is a policy that's been implemented through an ideological institution and a set of ideas and a set of powerful interests, which is imposing this set of policies on our countries. And I think that, you know, the blockupy and so on is great, but I think that for me what's lacking a little bit in the European context is this very explicit targeting. Of course, everyone talks about the Troika, but, you know, I think a lot more could be done in terms of really going after the institutions and the individuals and the interests that are at play in this whole process of structural adjustment in Europe. But I think that there are many difficulties in the European context, not least of which is the sort of political and institutional confusion of having multiple levels of governance, where you have the national government, which is to a greater or lesser extent dictated to by the European Union. And on that point, I just want to refer quickly to Stefan's analysis, which I think is great, no problem. And his sort of wish list of responses is also great, I mean, but it's a wish list. And what to me is missing in that is sort of the real power analysis of how do you make those wish lists reality? How do you convert those demands for reducing working hours into reality? How do you get the unions on board to support those sorts of demands? I live in France, and there are factory closures and delocalisation happening all over the place. And the response of the government is, of course, more austerity and refusing to, in most cases at least, refusing to support the beleaguered industries. But the response of the trade unions is to defend environmentally and socially destructive jobs, you know, at all costs. And I think that, you know, there has to be a real analysis of how come we're not able to rally the political forces and the movements to actually transform these absolutely agree with the proposals that Stefan has outlined, but how do we then translate those into real change and into political and social forces on the ground that will, in fact, occupy factories until they are collectivised or whatever? I think that there are some, you know, there's some things we can learn from the South, but by and large, I think that neoliberalism has won. You know, countries have been able to get out of their debt crisis, not because of debt cancellation, but because countries got absorbed into the global economy and they were able to pay off their debts, actually. You know, so I think in the end we don't have a lot of great examples of overcoming neoliberalism in the South, and in fact we're entering into a whole new era of extractivism, which actually makes the debt problem a little bit secondary. But at the same time, you know, if you look particularly at the sort of level of politics and political transformation, I think there are some very good stories and some very good experiences that we can learn from Indonesia, where they were able to overthrow a 26-year-old dictatorship of Suharto in the context of a political crisis. In Argentina, where they were able to, you know, get rid of several governments in just a month's time. So I think, you know, it's not as if there is any simple answer, but my own experience and my own observation, what is absolutely fundamental is to actually build movements on the ground and political forces which will not only target the institutions and call out and name names, but actually will bring together a sufficiently strong coalition of forces that can actually operationalise concrete demands and make them happen. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much. Well, I was trying quite hard to come up with some good questions, because I also fully agreed with what Stefan was saying. I was kind of struck actually by the similarity of the demands that you were putting forward and those that the alter-globalization movement articulated, say, around 15 years ago. And so the question that I have is extrapolating what you've argued, what would the degrowth position on the single European market be? Because in a way, the sort of left, at least in Germany, has been very, very loath, for very understandable reasons, to challenge European integration as a project on a more fundamental level. In fact, we've even chickened out about the Euro debate, but that's another question. You two choices. You can either answer my question about the single European market, or you can respond to the challenge laid down by Nicola. So you've got about 3 minutes. You probably have to make a choice. So go.
Okay, now I have the choice. I'm going to start with the European market and then see if I have a minute left. Well, I think, of course, it's difficult to answer this question for the whole movement, and it's impossible to answer that question. I can only give an answer for myself and maybe have an idea what people around me think. And my impression is that it is very similar to the alter-globalization movement, and we can talk about that more detailed, because I also think that's interesting in order to get coalitions going. I think in general the analysis is the following. We have, especially in Europe, a very strong economic integration, and in Europe we have some political integration, but we have less. And there's a mismatch. In Europe, on the global scale it's even more, but there's a mismatch in Europe. And from my point of view, we should go into two directions. You know, if the political integration is here and the economic integration is here, we should try to bring them together and increase the political integration and decrease the economic integration. That's kind of the very simple picture. What does that mean for the European market? I don't know. What I always propose is, you know, increase tax transport costs so that you have still a European market and people can move and goods can also move, but less goods would move. And also you can introduce capital controls so that capital can still move between countries, but less. That would be kind of my answer to that. Well, and to you, I can only say I had only 10 minutes and I tried to bring the answers and not the...
that's why you now have another two.
I have another two. Okay.
Give or take.
So, concerning the question how to realize this wish list, I think I can only talk about Germany because that's kind of the political situation that I know, and that's where we are working hard on bringing together this what we would call the socio-ecological movement. So, for example, within this degrowth conference as well, we tried to include workers' unions, as well as environmental organizations, as well as organizations and projects that that work more on social aspects. I think that's it. I leave the last minute to Jorgis.
Yeah, exactly. I was going to, Jorgis, since you sort of, in spite of telling me to be harsh, complained at various moments about me being harsh. Well, first of all, you had some concluding remarks, which I'd still be interested in. And the question I was going to ask you is, how would the movements that you talked about in Greece respond, again, to the agenda outlined by Stefan in his proposal? But again, if you want to talk about what you want to talk about, by all means, do feel free. Who am I?
No, thanks for the question. I think, first of all, according to the other two panelists, I think it's important for the degrowth movement, for environmental movements, for anti-capitalistic political organizations, to start working and answering the how question. We have a lot on the what question, and we need to start working on the how question. And this is, in my opinion, a very crucial point. And, well, I would say that for the social movements, there is a problem that has two faces, in my opinion. The first one is that we tend to deify, let's say, the social movements that are the, especially after the Indignados movement, we seem to think them as the political praxis of the 21st century. I don't think so. I think that power still matters, political parties still matter, institutions still matter, property still matters. We have to answer all these questions and bring up these questions within and with the help of the social movements. But on the other hand, the social movements themselves are places that produce in a very temporal and maybe spatial, let's say, distribution, bring up new spaces. That's how I want to see them, like new spaces confronting parts of growth, of accumulation, of, let's say, capitalistic order. But of course a transformative political imaginary is more than that. And I said that in the beginning. Just a small remark about what Tadjo asked me. I think, at least in Greece, I can speak about Greece, there is a process of unification of these social movements. And I think there is a process of unification for two reasons or on two different scales. One is how the dominant policies see these social struggles. Very quickly, they respond to them as threats for accumulation, for investments, for everything. So on one hand, we have them unified as a political force because of the dominant policies. On the other hand, they are unified because, as it was said for the example of other countries in the south, they try to let's say, explicitly target the what they call the enemy. Of course, it's the Troika, of course, it's, I don't know, the big investors and this stuff. Maybe not in the best way, but in this, there is also an aspect of unification. And that's why, for example, in Chalkidiki, we had, in terms of content and methodology, they followed the Syntagma Square example. And that's why, in the Syntagma Square example, they had... they followed the open assemblies that were firstly built in Keratea or in even previous movements of December 2008. So I think this is a kind of unification.
Thank you. And before we open to the floor, given that I've sort of been surprised again in a way between this, in terms of the similarities, by the similarities between sort of degrowth agenda in the crisis and the agenda we articulated in the alter-globalization movement some 15 years ago, I wanted to ask you, Nicola, because you used to run an organization, as you said, called Focus on the Global South, and one of the concepts associated with that organization and with its previous boss Walden Bellow was the concept of deglobalization. And to a certain extent, I heard echoes in what you were saying about deglobalization. So maybe if you could just spend a few minutes elaborating a little bit on this concept, just to kind of introduce it to the debate before we open to the floor.
Yeah, thanks. Okay, deglobalization. It is an attempt to think about a little bit the questions that Yorgos meant about power and institutions and markets and how we might reconfigure or reorient power, institutions and markets in a way which was socially and ecologically more just and sustainable. And I guess that the simplest way of thinking about deglobalization was basically, you know, like turning the world upside down, which was to say that, that in fact local economies, local markets, communities would be the foundation. So the principle of subsidiarity, so where political decision making and economic production would happen principally at the local level, and then as necessity and scale and so on demanded, these activities, both political and economic, would move up to a next level. So, for example, a public health system. Some aspects of a public health system can be implemented and organised locally, but others need to be, you know, down at a municipal level or a state level, etc. It's at training doctors and so on. So, I mean, that's just a rather banal example of having a bottom-up approach to economic and political life as opposed to a top-down. The approach also, I guess, was influenced a little bit by the Polanyi concept of having to re-embed the economy in society, so that in fact it was the society that was in control of the economy rather than the other way around. So democratizing institutions, financial institutions, decision-making institutions and so on were extremely important dimensions of the deglobalization thinking. It didn't completely ignore the necessity or the possibility that there would be international or regional institutions, but in the deglobalization framework, there would be much more plurality and competition and diversity between institutions, between economic and political practices, so that rather than having the sort of monolithic monoculture that we have at present of a sort of a neoliberal thinking, that there would be much more diversity of institutional forms, institutional frameworks and institutional practices, so that within that diversity and, if you like, competition between institutions, we wouldn't be subjected to the, you know, ever narrowing range of choices that we presently have. I think that to be self-critical, one could say that the deglobalization was a little bit sort of neo-Keynesian. It didn't really sort of jump completely out of the capitalist framework, but it was an attempt to at least think about how institutions and power could be devolved and redistributed in a different way, and that within that redistribution, alternatives and new forms of social and market relations could emerge. It didn't tackle, I think, the fundamental question of property. I think it was also a little bit weak in terms of the ecological perspective, and I know that people who've been thinking and working on the deglobalization concept are sort of rethinking that in terms of how to integrate more ideas about commons and commoning, addressing the question of property, addressing the question of ecology, and schematically how I would see that is not only re-embedding the economy within the society, but re-embedding society within ecology or nature or whatever you might call it. But I think that, as Tadzio said, I think there's a lot of continuity between the sort of different visions and proposals and alternatives that are emerging out of these different different spaces. But I still think that we're all grappling with the question that Yorgos posed, which is the how question. I think that's really at the heart of it, and I don't think any of us deglobalizers or degrowthers or commoners or whatever have really cracked the how question. But I do believe in sort of, you know, the potential of actually learning and doing in the practice. And so we have to start moving because out of that will emerge, I think, some of the answers.
Thank you very much, and thank you for your patience. So now the floor is open for questions, commentaries. It would be good if you, because this is being filmed, so in order for your question to be heard, you have to go up to that microphone. So rather than me taking hands, we can just do the proposed, like just walk up to the microphone, and then there'll be a cue at the microphone, and that'll be a self-organized way to... You know, so questions, comments, rants. If you want to rant, by all means, but do keep it under 2 minutes. And maybe if you could sort of yourself briefly, more or less, gender the speaking list, and you know, do the self-organize. Go.
Hi, my name's Andrew Perme, and I'm one of the very few English people here, I think. I wanted to, first of all, make a comment on the interesting tension which I think is emerging within this discussion and in much of the conference between what I'd call pessimism of the intellect, recognition of just how bad things are, and a certain optimism of the will, a hope that there might be some potential in some of the alternatives being elaborated. I'm not quite sure on which side of that contrast I fit. I think probably towards the pessimism end. I just wanted to raise, be utterly parochial and raise the position of Britain within all of this. Clearly we are not in the euro. There's no prospect of Britain being in the euro, not least because that stance is associated with the failed political project of early New Labour, and certainly in Britain the almost universally despised figure of Tony Blair. So it's an interesting position to be in. There's a distinct possibility we will not be in the European Union very much longer as well. There's the prospect of a referendum in a couple of years' time, which as things stand will almost certainly vote for withdrawal. Now, the Green or degrowth movement is obviously in a very difficult position because of this, and it's expressed by some of the ambiguities in the Green Party's position in Britain. On the one hand, the Green Party supports a referendum. On the other hand, it hopes for a positive result and support for the European Union. Whether we can have quite both of those positions is not entirely clear. I'd be interested in the panelists' attitude within this this situation towards Britain, and any ideas you might have as to what kind of stance we might take from a degrowth perspective.
Hello.
And then, of course, the usual, if you could introduce yourselves.
Sure. My name is Miriam Lang. I live in Quito, Ecuador. I have been living in Latin America for the last 15 years. And I'm very grateful for this panel for being able to reconnect to European debates. And I work at the Rosa Luxemburg Foundation there in the Andean region.
Can I quickly interrupt? Are people hearing well? Because
no?
Maybe we need that microphone a little... maybe we actually need to have more, I don't know what you, you know, in DJ terms,
put more juice on the microphone. Not only at the panelists. Better? Yeah? Okay. So, I live in Latin America. I work at the Rosa Luxemburg Foundation for the Andean region in Quito. And I will try to make a complicated but hopefully useful point. And the jet lag is really pressing on my brain, so I'll do my best. I want to relate both to Nicola and to Stefan with what I'm going to say. I was somehow startled that the solutions you proposed, Stefan, although I agree very much with the general concepts, were rather state-centered. And I think I can bring a point that although Latin America has gone through all these neoliberal austerity politics in the 90s, it now is experiencing a sort of post-neoliberal phase where we have the comeback of the state. And I would say from the point of view of social movements today, this is not necessarily a positive experience. So we are trying to explore which solutions we can find that are non-state-centered and non-market-centered. Because if you give back all power to the state in a historical era where the welfare state is not working anymore because of all these problems with easy growth Barbara mentioned this morning, you are centralizing power very much. And our experience of the comeback of the state, which was really desired by the people, is that it cuts away every possibility of autonomy. And the state is really taking over a sort of very vertical top-down leadership and is implementing what capitalism needs in countries that had social movements that were strong enough to wipe away several governments. Now we have almost no social movements, and we have a state that is allowing mining companies, oil companies, green capitalism to just mercantilize the rest of the countries that still were living under non-capitalist conditions, or at least relatively non-capitalist conditions. So I think that's a very important thing to think about. I also don't know if I would be satisfied with only strengthening the European Parliament in terms of democracy. At least in the Andean region, there are lots of concepts of democracy circulating, like communitarian democracy, not only direct and representative, but different kinds. And I think this should also be opened as a space of experimentation. What sorts of democracy can we also think of? And in Europe, to start with the constitution, I think, and then see if we can rethink those scales also, and not only stick to the local level or the regional level, but when, what can we build in between? And the whole commoning thing, I think, is really important too in this sphere between state and market. Really empower other collectives in society and think of other types of institutions. I don't say we don't need institutions. I only say that those that we have maybe limit our fantasy to think about other ones. And finally, about integration, regional integration, I'm not sure if I would agree with decreasing economic integration and increasing political integration. Maybe you're aware of the debates about regional integration and the experiments we had in Latin America in the last years with ALBA and UNASUR and all those integration from the left experiments. And I think there are visions like from Eduardo Gudinas that are really interesting about making economic regional integration not in a competitive way, but in a complementary way. That would be a different sort of economic integration where ecosystems are respected and different regions in a whole produce complementary goods in order not to have global trade, but and not only local trade, but regional trade, and make that all more ecological too. Thanks.
Excellent. Thank you for that very, very rich comment. If that's what you like when you're jet lagged, I'd hate to be in a confrontational debate with you when you're awake. That would be.
My name is Lasse. I'm a sort of grad student and activist in Berlin. I have two questions, but I'll try to be as concise as possible. The first one is more specific and practical to Yorgos. You were talking about the low land prices in Greece at the moment. Do you see any potential in there for alternative economic projects to try to even get access to land because the situation is that a situation that can be exploited for that purpose as well and not just for speculative purposes? And the other one would be a more general political one. I think neo-Keynesian is also perhaps an appropriate term for the wish list that was presented. So my question would be, from a degrowth perspective, is that really sort of our best hope in terms of real politics at the moment in Europe as a movement to go for that, at least in the short term? Or is there any potential for sort of more radical degrowth platform or vision as a serious contender in European politics, I mean, for the next couple of years, just, or is that just for sort of a far future? Thanks.
like two more comments or so? This is quite.
Hello, my name's Alice. So this isn't my specialisation. In fact, on Friday I'm talking about technology. I come from the Centre for Alternative Technology in Wales. So I'm speaking as a citizen of Britain rather than a specialist here. And my comment was really about just an observation. Because we seem to be talking about the differentiation between North and South, not just globally, but within Europe. And as a citizen of Britain, I see a lot of the things that you talk about happening in Greece and in Spain actually happening in our country too. We have privatisation of our services. I mean, we've already privatised our electricity, our power generation, our water, our utilities, but now we're seeing a privatisation, for example, of the NHS, which we love. We're cutting public services, care, local goods such as libraries, schools. Our education system is all being cut. That's being forced from central government onto regional governments. So they're actually losing power in this as well. So we have loss of democratisation in our country as well. We're seeing planning laws relaxed so that companies can come in and buy up land and use it as they wish, rather than land that was previously owned by our government and used for sort of common land for people, including, buildings as well. So we're seeing facilities that were previously used for the people that was appropriated by the government being sold off at very, very small amounts, actually, to be able to make return, to be able to pay back this money that we used to bail out the bank. So all of these things are really, really similar. But the difference that I see between the two situations is that there is very little resistance in the UK. We're not angry about it. We're buying it. We're saying, great, we need to do these things. Yeah, we need to impose all of these things on ourselves because it's very important that we support the financial institution. And we're not angry. And I think if the key to some of these changes are our resistance, our movement, our forces, our unifying, we no longer have strength in our unions in the UK. They were dashed in the 80s. We already have a depoliticisation of our populace. We don't care about democracy. We don't care about voting. How? My question really is: who is in the worst situation? and how can we learn from each other to be able to get past this?
Just to quickly democratise the process. First, I was going to abuse facilitator's privilege and point to the fact that British cultural stereotypes revolve around keeping calm and carry on. Obviously, there's no that much anger. But that's a stereotyping, and I'll take that back. I didn't say that. I think I said it online. Do you guys want to come back now? Because there were some very, very rich comments, and I just wanted to thank you actually for the very rich comments, because sometimes as a facilitator, when you open up to the floor, you're like, oh my God, what are people going to say? And just really... thank you. Those have been great comments and questions. So do you guys want to come in now, or do you want to have a few more? It's up to you. I know.
Good now?
Yeah.
Okay. Right. So hang in there. We'll do a... That was actually there's rather a wait. We'll go back.
It was a wait?
Yeah. Sorry. I didn't make that quite clear. Sorry. Okay. We'll... How about we start with the other way around? Nicola, do you want to go first, and then Yorgos, and then Stefan?
Okay. I have some points, quickly.
First of all, thanks for all the comments and the questions. It is a very interesting discussion. So I will take it in the order that the questions were. First of all, about Britain, I think it's an excellent discussion, and I don't want to say that I know a lot of things, but I think the question that was coming from the British comrade, it is very, very interesting, and I leave it there. I mean, we have to discuss it, because a lot of times we see Europe and we forget about Britain, the special connection that there is with Britain. I was in London last week. And I'm always amazed when I go to this city, in a bad way, sorry. about Ecuador and the issues that were mentioned, I think there comes a very, very interesting point, and this is the point of the state. And I want to problematize it a bit. So I understand that there is a kind of new statist, governments or political persons. But we have to problematize the question and understand it by answering some questions. Why people support still these leaders in this way? Is there a process of transformation in these societies like Ecuador at the moment or the other left governments in Latin America? There is an increase of the everyday life, of the quality of life, of the welfare state that matters in these societies. And at the same time, how are these confronted with land issues, with environmental issues, with these questions? So I think, and I say that also for Greece, that the state question is a very crucial one, because I do believe that there should be a process of opening up autonomous spaces, but at the same time, taking power of institutions and state issues. So, and specifically, one last comment about the specific question about Greece and the land. I'm not sure if I understood it well, but you asked what is the process also from the part of the movement or for what they want to do from the dominant politics with the land issue. Is it that? Ah, okay.
If it is possible for radical alternative movements to buy land.
Okay, sorry, yeah. Well, the thing is that in Greece, first of all, you have to understand a bit the history. In Greece, there was always, as in most of the European South countries, there was a very small ownership of the land. There was not land centralization, like we had the big landowners. And it was a matter of the middle class in Greece, that you always have to have a small portion of land. Either it is a small house or it is a land in a village where you can grow your stuff. So there is a huge transformation into centralizing this land, giving it to big landowners. So at the moment, what the movements are doing is It's a defensive issue. It is issues of trying to work against the evictions, at least in the big city centers, against the eviction of the houses of people that are not able to pay the so-called rent loans. And on the other hand, there are small projects, as you said, of either occupation or buying land. In city centers, but also in the land, where there are small agricultural projects, but they are heavily attacked by the state and by police. There are some great examples, but they have to face a lot of problems with police brutality, at least.
Stefan, maybe you want to go next. And also, again, the question of this, the state and of autonomy and of movements in relation to that, I think, is a very, very interesting one, sort of to expand a bit.
Yeah, cool. That's actually the one I wanted to start with. So I'm just going to say, keep my comments to those aspects that I actually can say something about. For example, about Britain, I don't know too much. Okay, about the state. Who made that comment? Ah, yeah. It's true, my analysis was very much state-centered, and as Alberto Acosta said yesterday, nobody's perfect. I'm an economist, and I guess that's in my profession. I can say something about that, and I think I can say less about non-market and non-state focused solutions. I think they are very important. I'm just not an expert on it. I also think that the structures in the state are still very important, because from my experience and from my analysis and from projects that I hear from who try to lead a post-growth or degrowth life, in reality already there are many structural problems that need to be solved on a state base. Just to give one example, in Germany there is this firm type that is called Genossenschaft. It's a very democratic firm type, but it's very expensive and very complicated to actually initiate such a firm, and that needs to be changed. Just to give one small example where it's just necessary that you also change the national framework. My second comment goes to the neo-Keynesian remark that it was very, or post-Keynesian, that the kind of policies that I laid out overlap a lot with the neo-Keynesian proposals. It's true, there's quite some overlap. I think there's also something positive in that, because that gives the ground for coalitions with, for example, trade unions. I would disagree that it was solely post-Keynesian, because just to give the examples again, there was working hour reduction, environmental policies are sometimes within the post-Keynesian framework, but not very often, and the focus on local economies and with that a kind of deglobalization is also not, as far as I know, within their policy recommendations. Generally speaking, I found it quite a difficult task that I gave myself, or that Tadjo gave me, to lay out post-growth policies regarding the euro crisis. There was basically no work on that, as far as I know. So this was kind of a try by myself and my colleagues at the Konzeptwerk, but there's a lot of work to be put in there as well. Two more remarks. Actually, one to the question from Tachio, because I didn't answer it before. The overlap between the globalization movement and the degrowth movement, I think it's important to, or a good way to think about it is that the degrowth movement very much comes from the science, and the science gives very general frameworks how it could look like, and it comes from very concrete projects that try to live the life and produce in a degrowth manner. And as far as I understand, the auto-globalization movement, that was before my time, but it developed more like an activist movement. And I think the degrowth movement at the moment tries to figure out what are actually our claims regarding policies on a national, European, and global level. I think that is not developed so far yet. It's just because they come from different milieus, from different sectors of the society. And one last comment, very short, that in Britain there is no resistance, in Germany there's also no resistance. I mean, Germany was, of course there is resistance, but very, from my point of view, very small. It's also surprising to me because, I mean, of course Germany is not comparable with other European countries in the crisis, but real wages for the majority of the people don't increase, haven't increased for 25 years. Why is there nobody calling for action? For me, one explanation would be that people see, okay, within other European countries, the people have even worse conditions, so they are happy to be German and not coming from Spain and Greece. But I think there is potential for resistance because big parts of society don't benefit from the where the economy works at the moment.
Okay, yeah, a lot of very interesting discussion and ideas. What would I want to talk about? I want to just go back to an earlier comment that Yorgos made, which was he's sort of reminding us about the importance of power, institutions, property and parties, right, that we need to still pay attention. And he, maybe this is an overinterpretation, was I think a little bit dismissive of the importance of social movements. And I mean, I think that there are social movements and there are social movements. And we've seen that, you know, social movements in Bolivia have been able to completely change the balance of forces and then the face of power in that country. And I'm thinking of a global movement like La Vea Campesina, which is a sort of a very grounded and large movement of peasant farmers, which is functioning and trying to influence all of those things, parties, institutions, the state, and so on. You know, so I think, and of course the trade union movement, the women's movement, I mean, there are many movements that are extremely embedded, you know, for good or bad. It's not really the point, but I mean, I think maybe I misunderstood a little bit the point, but movements are not sort of ephemeral. I think movements are real, and in fact, movements are fundamental for the reconfiguring of the balance of forces that exist in different contexts, which leads me a little bit to the comment and the reflections on the state and the role of the state and the importance of the state and so on. And maybe this is perhaps extremely simplistic, but you know, the state I think is to a large extent a kind of a concrete manifestation of power, you know, the balance of forces and so on. You know, actually, I'm probably a little bit sympathetic to the contradictions and the dilemmas that countries like Ecuador and Bolivia are confronting, because in fact they can't operate as Bolivia or as Ecuador. They operate in a global system with a 500 years history of colonialism, and extractivism, and exploitation, and debt, and so to imagine that it's actually kind of simple to just sort of change things, I think, is of course it's very frustrating, and there are lots of problems and disappointments and so on that emerge out of that, and but I think that there is a reality that all of these countries are members of the World Trade Organization, for example. And that, you know, if they suddenly decided to completely change the trade rules to block any sort of, but No. The World Trade Organization. I'm saying the World Trade Organization. Okay, and of course I know that there are many problems, but all I'm saying is that the state. Exists in a global system as well, and that there are global institutions that and norms and so on that are extremely powerful, financial capital, corporations, the World Trade Organization. So, there are power demands coming from the outside, and there are movements and demands coming from the inside, and there are also the reality of unmet material needs that the country is trying to address within. So I think I think that the state is important, but it's extremely conflictual and contradictory and difficult. Tadzios.
Sorry, I'm trying to signal because there's a lot of people who want to speak, and we've already been up on the panel for quite a while. So back to you folks.
I'm Beth, PhD student from London. I had a suggestion, which I guess.
Brits.
Sorry?
There are quite a few Brits, unlike what
yeah,
the,
I know,
what
we're
our friend
dominating.
Over there
if
pointed
we're few,
out.
Then we're certainly dominating the question time. It's a proposal which I guess falls into the state-centered post-Keynesian wish list. Sorry, I realise there are limitations with that, but I think it's an interesting proposal. So in the UK, there have been various more radical economists and politicians and NGOs calling for a state-led stimulus programme, a green stimulus, like a massive rollout of insulation and green transport and things like that, which prepare us for post-carbon future. But the difference being that it wouldn't be funded by borrowing from private financial institutions, but that we would use the state's power of money creation to fund that. So it's also been called green quantitative easing, for example. Now, I know that's easier to be done in the UK because we have sovereignty over our own currency, but I wonder if there could be a way of doing that, say in Greece, where the government starts a parallel complementary regional currency and does a big job creation scheme focused on green infrastructure, paid in a parallel currency also to stimulate the local economy.
I am Thomas Kesslering from Switzerland. I have taught a couple of years in Brazil, and now I am teaching regularly in Mozambique. But my point is a different one. Some reflections on degrowth and de-globalization. The concept of globalization has different meanings. I think mainly we spoke on economic globalization, but the globalization is more than that. We are here, this is a global international congress with Alberto Acosta coming from South America. Then we have the human rights, which are an ethical acquisition of the 20th century, depending on a state system which is universally valid, globally valid. Then we have global challenges like climate change or the atomic stuff and so on, which should not get into the hand of terrorists. So we have a couple of challenges we cannot resolve nationally or locally. So I would not give up the concept of globalization. But now, what is important, what is less important? I would say that the majority of the problems of globalization are on the level of economic globalization. And mainly, as I understand the things, on the financial markets, globalization of financial markets. One of the consequences is that the richer get even richer. From last year to this year, we have more than an increase of more than 100 billionaires. Instead, the poor do not get better off. That's one of the problems I would attribute to financial markets. It's not only IMF, it's also World Bank, it is WTO, and all the multinational companies. I come from Switzerland, we have many multinational companies, and we have many NGOs also who concentrate, for instance, on Nestle or on Glencore or on Novartis or on the banks and so on. So that's much complicated to work. We cannot simply fight against IMF. It's much more complicated than that. And mainly, for finishing, there are also local problems. When I think on the South European countries, which are suffering by the EU politics, but I would say that one of the reasons of unemployment is the fact that most of countries have no dual educational system, as Germany has, Switzerland has, Denmark, and so on. An education of professional education due to small and medium enterprises. This Germany could, or Switzerland could, help introduce in the southern countries. Thank you.
My name is Alvine Schreiber-Martens. Yeah. I live in a genossenschaftlich verfasstes Gemeinschaftsprojekt in a
cooperatively organized commune.
Yes, and the land it's a very small piece of land, is in this form of ownership. And I want to emphasize the question of land ownership. I think the land is quite different from all other commodities. Land is not made by men. This is a word from Henry George. Perhaps you know he is a very old land reformer, more than 150 years old. And why for the market, the normal market it is not good for land, because if the demand grows up, the offer may not be grown up. That means the land, the rents grow, and this is, in very short words, the reason why land may not be in private ownership. Or the property rights had to be split up. That means, I cannot explain in English, it's difficult for me in the moment. But I think to split up these property rights is perhaps a possibility. And I think the social movements, for example, in lands of South America, they have a very important Aufgabe.
Task.
In respect to the land ownership. And then I want to say, it's the question of market. If we, or I want to overcome neoliberalism, and so I think it's very important to have a very differentiated point of view on the market, because I said the market on land or generally natural resources has totally different characteristics from the market of normal commodities that are made by men. And financial markets are as well different. I want to ask, especially to Greece, there is, I think, since the beginning of last year, the proposition of a parallel currency, of a currency that circulates regional, but it could be national in Greece, and the regional currencies help the re-regionalization, what is a very important statement, with the energy and with a local market in difference to the global market.
An organizational question. So who's currently on the list of people who still want to speak? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, I would close the list there unless somebody, basically if you get up now and run over there, that's your last point. Otherwise, speak now, forever hold your peace. I would say we've got 20 minutes. So because I'd like to give the people on the panel another sort of 2 minutes for closing remarks, let's say if you could each keep your comments to about 2 minutes, that would be great. Thank you. And by the way, if you speak longer than 2 minutes, you're taking time from your fellow speakers. So it's again about self-organization.
My name is Heinz Czernohorst from the internet magazine Schattenblick, which is covering up the whole conference from our point of view. I cut it very short. Greece, can we hope within the structure of the European Union to solve any of the problems of Greece? Referring to the debate between KKE and Syriza, to cut it short.
KKE being the
European Union, or can we solve the problems within this European Union?
KKE being the more traditionally communist party in Greece, which has some running intellectual battles with Syriza, I'm told.
Thank you. My name is Rajni Bakshi. I'm here from Bombay, India. Localization, the importance of localization has been on the table since at least 1999, Seattle. I think the challenge before this forum is, can we now move the discourse to a greater specificity? And so my question to the panel is that in your context of the euro crisis, what would say be the 5 tangibles that could be worked on in the short term? What is the short, medium, and long term for localization, intangibles? The other quick question, somewhat tangentially related, is that in what way do we work for economic localization in the sense that I think we are all agreed generally, and at the same time counter the rise of right-wing groups? Because in India, as you know, we've recently elected a right-wing government, and this is a very serious fault line, that there is now a right-wing mobilization that is pro-localization of a kind, and quite honestly, we are struggling. The progressive forces in India are struggling to find a narrative that can bring forth a progressive, in the sense that I think we all understand here, a non-racial, egalitarian, non-discriminatory model of localization. Thank you.
Thank you for raising that point. That's very, very important in any discussion about localization.
My name is Stephanie Hürtgen. I come from Germany. And I want to make a pre-remark and then first remark on the question. The pre-remark is that I think we have to be aware that unemployment, misery, poverty does not only exist since European crisis, what we call European crisis. I made a lot of research in Eastern Europe, and there it exists for a couple of time, as you may know, and it is called transformation. And we have the same experiences and the same statistics and the same clashes of social or questions of social exclusion and all that. So this was the pre-remark, just to not fall in that trap that, in my point of view, the official debate puts on the table, arguing that before crisis everything was fine, and I think it is not the case. We have to question, as we can argue, the whole thing. This was the pre-remark, and my point and question is in another direction. I want to go back a bit to your abstract you formulated to invite us to your panel. And there you put the question, how to deal with false degrowth in Greece, in Eastern Europe right now, even in countries like, as we have heard, Britain, France, and so on. And this brings me to the question, or brings me to the idea that I'm very sorry, but I'm still confused when we talk about growth, degrowth. I really do never know what is meant exactly. Because are we talking about growing? It looks very simple, but it's a deep question, I think. Are we talking about growing profits? Are we talking about growth and degrowth of profits? Are we talking about growing needs? Barbara this morning spoke about growing desires. I mean, these questions are on the table if you look at poverty, if you look at breaking down or the breaking down of medical care systems and so on. So these questions are not theoretical ones, but I think we have to be more clear about what kind of growth and degrowth we are debating. Also, and this is the last point, because the other side, the official debate, has got its narrative. This is to attract capital, to bring back profits, and then to include, to guarantee more inclusion to people. And we do know that this does not take place, so it's more difficult. But my question to you, especially to the colleague from Athens, from Greece, would be, is degrowth, the degrowth conception in your country, really, as it is discussed now, a good political angle to attack the profit, let's say, narrative of of the neoliberal side in Europe today? Thank you.
Hi, my name is Josh Curtis. I'm from Australia, but I'm studying at the Irish Centre for Human Rights in Galway. This is the first time I've been to a degrowth conference, and I'm very new to the whole thing, and I'm wondering if I'm in the right place to ask this question. But I'm studying law, so I thought that it might be worth bringing this up because it seems like a very obvious thing to me, and I apologize if it's too obvious, but it seems to me that neoliberalism is not just a political project, but it's a legal project. And this to me goes directly to the how of the implementation. That from my perspective, a lot of the policies that everyone's putting forward, I think are great policies, except that they're illegal. Quite often they're illegal. Like, governments can't do them because they've bound themselves to not be able to do them. Is part of the reason why I chose the Eurocrisis panel here, because I think that it was reasonably well understood that Europe is one of the most neoliberally legalized regions in the world. That's the basic point, essentially, is that neoliberalism has been locked in by law. So as far as the how goes, I wondered how people are planning on getting around that simple thing. But I just wanted to point out one specific thing very quickly, which I think might be a key. In my work, what I come across a lot with the implementation of these policies is in the sense that comes up to a barrier of non-discrimination. So everything's been leveled, that there can't be any discrimination between the local and the international. So you can't put in place policies that favour local development because they discriminate against foreign investors. Sorry, we can't do that. So I'll leave it at that. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Very important question. And thank you for being at this conference, and we hope you come back to the next ones. Because we definitely need more legal people. Like, there's always too few of those around. And more Australians is what Nicola says.
Hello, I'm Urs from Germany. I've been working with ATTAC for some years, and I would like to come back to the title of the panel here, because that's what I was actually really curious about. Because when we're talking about the Euro crisis and criticizing the current European policies on that issue, most ideas that come up are largely neo-Keynesian and are ideas how to come back to a growth path, which actually, given the ecological situation, is not really the idea. Unfortunately, as Stefan has pointed out, there is hardly any literature, anything written about really this issue, degrowth strategies in the Euro crisis, and especially strategies for the movement. Now, I can't come up with any either. I was curious to hear what people have to say here about that, because I can fairly easily imagine state strategies towards degrowth in this situation, which would have to involve reducing debts by either controlled inflation or a haircut, strengthening social security, and giving incentives for local self-organization structures. But apart from, of course, strengthening and building these local structures, for local self-organization and self-sufficiency, I can't really think of what the movement would have to do to get on a degrowth path in this situation, which now is really, it could be a window of opportunity, because everything is changing now, everything is in movement. Yeah, that was my question.
Thank you very much. So it would be really asking a lot of the speakers to respond to all those points and comments and questions in the 2 minutes that I'll allot to each of them. But basically, I'd invite you to contribute some final thoughts, pick out some things that you thought were interesting to comment on. What order do you guys want to go? I'll take in hands, volunteers, excellent.
No, I was pointing you.
He volunteered you. Okay, so that's very good.
Thank you. Okay, I'm going to give some comments again. Shortly. Concerning the green quantitative easing, a nice word, I think it's probably a good idea to invest in the green sectors, but never forget that you need to shrink at the same time in other sectors. Because, that's the whole discussion within this degrowth and post-growth discourse that you know, you have the rebound effect. It's not possible to decouple if you just do a post-Keynesian stimulus package. I mean, it makes a difference if it's green or not green, but that's not enough. I don't know the situation in Britain again, but in Germany, you have this. You have a very similar situation. I think that the Greens, for example, call for investments in the green energy sector, but at the same time are very reluctant to say that what is it called, brown coal lignite?
Lignite. Yeah.
The production of lignite needs to decrease. You know, if you demand the one, please don't forget the other. I really like this five tangible things on localization. I'm going to give it a try. So how are we going to bring about localization? Of course, I only had 2 minutes, but perhaps some ideas. They are not new. Local currencies as a complementary currency, I think, is a good idea to regionalize the economy. Then, as I already said, public expenditures can be put mainly into the local economy. The local ownership of public goods can be supported. So for a good example in Germany, again, at the moment is the ownership by the public of energy production, increased transport costs. And the fourth one would now is fight TTIP I have on my paper. And that is, of course, connected to all the others, because as another commentator said, concerning the legal structures, it's very many of the policies that we propose are not possible within the legal structures, especially on the international area, on the international level. And that is why, well, of course, if we have something like the TTIP, you know, the TTIP, the free trade agreement that is at the moment on the table between USA and the EU, if such a new legal form is on the agenda, I think we have to fight it. And of course, it would be even better if we could bring a different kind of trade regime on the agenda. There's a proposal in Alternative Trade Manifesto, it is called, I think. So, you know, if we get stronger, we can maybe push even positive trade regimes. But at the moment, I think we have to fight the negative ones. Is my time already over?
I think it's the alternative trade mandate, and I'm just saying that because it's actually very interesting to go and look it up, because there's some very, very interesting work that's gone into that alternative trade mandate.
There was either of you? Okay.
It's so interesting. Just on the green quantitative easing, which is excellent expression, but I wonder if we could also, I'd like to sort of throw into that what we might call a like care quantitative easing or social quantitative easing. Oh, sorry, maybe, okay. I'd just like to add to the green quantitative easing the idea of like a care quantitative easing, because I think that, we can do a lot of stuff in the ecological field and green infrastructure and so forth, but there's enormous deficit in terms of the care in the societies in which we live, caring for elderly, caring for families, caring for, you know, having the time and the means for social reproduction. I think there's a huge gap there. So, and I think it's particularly in amongst feminist economists and so on, there's a lot of thinking around this issue, not to monetize care as such, but to think how these activities which actually enable societies to reproduce themselves could somehow be taken out of the monetarized sector and could become a common good for the whole of society. I mean, to put some kind of reality to this, I'm old enough to sort of now be responsible for sort of elderly parents and so on. And the cost, you know, of having people in nursing homes and so on is absolutely astonishing. I mean, it's a scam. The whole thing is just such a rip-off. And, you know, and the regulations or the lack of regulations allow these to be sort of profit-making machines, which is, it's devastating for families and the sort of small bit of accumulation that normal people have been able to do in their life gets completely, completely taken away by these private nursing homes. So I think, I mean, there are thousands of sectors, but just to think about the care that society needs to be able to reproduce itself and to look after the more vulnerable sectors, I think is very important. And we can think about, you know, what sort of, how to make resources available to create decent jobs in these sectors that don't that aren't seen as a profit sector, but rather as a common good. The only other thing I wanted to comment was, well, the person said go back to the title, and I think that what's clear to me is that there is in fact a lot of work to do, right, in terms of actually getting much more concrete in terms of, you know, setting out a strategy on how to go from A to B. And I think I really take very well the point made by Josh, you know, because in fact the neoliberal rhetoric is deregulation, but in fact the re-regulation of the whole political and economic system and the social system has you know, made neoliberalism the default in almost every sector. So, you know, I think that's a really interesting challenge to think how we can move using all of these instruments and spaces available to actually roll back some of these neoliberal constraints. Yes, so we have a lot of work to do. Thanks.
Thank you. Quickly. Firstly, I totally agree with Nicolas' previous comment on the social movements, the importance, and I was totally misunderstood on this part. I just wanted... No, maybe I was answering to myself. I just don't want to show... a picture of Greece like the social movements are everywhere on the streets and everything. I just wanted to problematize this thing because a lot of bad things, let's say, are going on. There are a lot of questions, a lot of interesting points. We can go for coffee to discuss a lot of this. I just want to say two things, somehow to sum up. The one thing is the issue of localization of different scales, local, national, international. And this goes also to the currencies, the attempts and all this discussion. Well, I go back to the example of Greece. For sure, the Eurozone decision for Greece was a huge disaster, but it has a lot of consequences that now are very difficult to confront. So what I want to say in other words is to problematize these different scales, local, national, international. For instance, first of all, on the social movements level, there are a lot of attempts and actually successful attempts, not only for local currencies, maybe they are not in this type, they were time currencies during the Indignados movements on the Syntagma Square, and they continued for like 5 or 6 months later on. But there is a kind of new solidarity network among the society that is really important. Is the No Middlemen initiatives that they are directly, a kind of directly connection between producers and consumers. There are a lot of social clinics and social pharmacies all over Greece. There are some social schools, like giving special lessons to poorer people. So there is a kind of, let's say, localization, or at least in terms of services providing. On the other hand, there are cases of taking control, workers' control, taking the ownership of factories and they are not able to give the products to the, because they are excluded from the markets. The case of Viomé, maybe you have heard it, it's a crucial case, that they produce chemical products that are only distributed among, it's been an excellent work, that being distributed among solidarity networks, but still they are excluded from the markets on a national level, on international level, and this brings up a lot of problems. So this is about the different levels of localization. And finally, I really love this discussion about the degrowth movement because there was a question, is degrowth a good political angle to look on the crisis in Greece and promote alternatives? Please don't take me as the offending representative of the social movements in Greece. There are a lot of Greek people here, degrowthers. I don't say myself as a degrowther. I don't call myself a degrowther. So I don't think degrowth, it is a good way to answer this political crisis in Greece, but let me discuss it during the coffee break. And please discuss with other people that they think it is.
All right, so this is probably the single most concrete answer that we've gotten at this entire conference. So also sort of just two words, last words from me. The first one is obviously thank you for your amazing contributions and the speakers on the panel. I was going to try and summarize something. You know, we have a lot to do in order to get beyond the state-centered post-Keynesian wish list that somebody pointed out. Really, I think the takeaway is there's a lot of work to do in terms of bringing the sort of degrowth movement to a position where strategies can be articulated, where demands can be articulated, where it becomes a sort of political movement rather than something that is born of science on the one hand and niche projects on the other. And I think that becomes quite clear here. And I hope this was just the sort of, this is another total like banal commonplace, the start of a discussion rather than the, oh God, I'm going to stop. Right. So I also wanted to thank the folks doing the techniques. Thank you very much. And finally, point to some publications that we as the Rosa Luxemburg Foundation, in a complete ignorance of the degrowth motto, have piled a few hundreds out there. It's called more or less degrowth from the left. Have some here or there. Thank you very much. Now enjoy your lunch. I'll be back in a minute. Yeah, I know. I have the same problem after every panel. I'm always like,
thanks,
Jonas.
That was great.
Excellent. I really love the last comment was spectacular. Oh. I love it.